Today in this demo, we will see how our code performs load balancing in SDN framework. We have used Floodlight as our controller. As per Floodlight's requirement, we need a folder named /var/lib/floodlight with chmod 777 privileges. I've already ran the shell script written to do just that. This is done to avoid data conflicts from previous runs. Next, we start the Floodlight controller. Next, we run the Mininet topology, which looks something like this. The small numbers in blue are the port numbers to which the host or link of the switch is connected to. Let's open Wireshark now and set it to capture traffic on switch 1, port 1. The best path for H1 to H3 and H4, that is H1 to H3 and H1 to H4, should be via switch 1, port 3. So we should not see any traffic on switch 1, port 1. We don't see any packets from H1 to H3 or H1 to H4 in this current port. Let's try capturing the traffic on port 3 of switch 1. We do see packets from H1 to H3 and H1 to H4. So the Wireshark test passes. And what we are saying in theory is indeed true, that the best path for H1 to H3 and H1 to H4 is from switch 1, port 3. Let's run the load balancer algorithm. We need to specify the host 1 and host 2 between whom we want to perform the load balancing. The neighboring host argument has been added in the code, but it's optional and can be easily removed. So for now, I'll just add the neighboring host of the second host. On running initially, we will get all the information such as port mappings, MAC addresses, switch cluster, switch ID, etc. However, the best path won't be decided until the REST API gives us the transmission rate. Initially, the REST APIs don't update the transmission rate immediately. So running it after few seconds will indeed update the transmission rate of the link, and we will select the link with minimum transmission rate. To check if the new path is added, we can check the flow table. Here is a REST API request, and here are the flows which have been added to each of these switches which are in the best path. For now, all links are having same bandwidth, but if links with different bandwidths are added, then transmission rate of that link is equal to the total bandwidth minus current bandwidth load. On capturing data on switch 1, port 3, we find out that the packets of 10.0.0.4 are not being received or sent. So this proves that the new path has been loaded. Now we will capture packets on switch 2 port 3, switch 1 port 2, switch 1 port 1, switch 5 port 1, switch 5 port 2, and switch 3 port 4, which is the current best path for pinging H1 to H4 or sending data from H1 to H4. I know this because I have already tested this topology. On running Iperf, we will find that we receive 10.0.0.4 packets, which is H1 to H4 packets. We will also see 10.0.0.3 packets as S2 port 3 is included. But now let's try capturing only data on S1 port 1, and we won't find the packets from 10.0.0.3. But we will find the packets from 10.0.0.4, which simply proves that load balancing is working. And Iperf results also show that the average data transferred after load balancing increases, and the average ping time decreases. This is how the fat tree topology for our example looks like. The switch ID has been specified in hexadecimal 2, as Floodlight will convert it to hex. So this is for our better understanding of the topology. The process is the same that we followed for demo 1. We first create the /var/lib/floodlight folder using the shell script, then run floodlight controller, and then create the fat tree mininet topology. Once the mininet topology has been created, we can check switch 1 port 3 to see if packets for H3 and H4 are sent or received by H1. And when we do that, we find that there is no such packets being sent or received on switch 1 port 3. In short, this is not the current best path. We do the same thing for switch 1 port 4, and we can see packets for H3 and H4 from H1 and vice versa, which proves that this is the best path for both the hosts. Now we run the load balancer script. Again, we need to run this a few times till REST updates the transmission rates. Once the transmission rates have been updated, the new best path will be pushed for H4. So if we check the interfaces S1 port 3, S21 port 1, S21 port 2, S2 port 3, we will be able to see H4 packets but no H3 packets. So the load balancer is working. But we need to confirm this, because by theory, on switch 1 port 4, we should no longer be able to send or receive H4 packets. On checking this in Wireshark, we can confirm that load balancing is working. Here are the results of Iperf before and after load balancing. So this is Iperf on H1 to H3 before load balancing, and this is on H1 to H4 before load balancing. This is H1 to H3 after load balancing, and H1 to H4 after load balancing. Next is Iperf on fat tree topology. Again, H1 to H3 before load balancing, H1 to H4 before load balancing, H1 to H3 after load balancing, and H1 to H4 after load balancing. And as stated, this is the ping result. So this is for R topology, and the average ping time is around 3.494. After load balancing, it is just 0.1518. So this is before load balancing on the fat tree topology, and this is after load balancing. So there's a huge difference. That's it with this demo. I hope you liked it.